So when we think about what motivates people, maybe the first thing to think about is what we think motivates people and what don't we understand motivates people. And maybe the first misunderstanding is about the pleasure principle. So we have this idea of we have the right to pursue happiness and we're trying to be happy and that's really what we're pursuing, happiness. But think about it. What gives you happiness in a way that is observable? Maybe sitting on the beach drinking mojito, or maybe sitting on a sofa watching a sitcom. But if you do almost anything that is useful, meaningful, that you take pride of, it's not the same things. But imagine you have a whole life of sitting on the beach drinking mojito. How happy would that life be? So the first, I think, mistake is that we pursue momentary happiness rather than longer term happiness. So we do the things that will make us laugh out loud today, kind of, you know, not always laugh out loud, but you know, kind of like that. And we don't do the things that are difficult and complex and challenging, but give us a very different sense of happiness. Think about something like running a marathon. You don't see anybody happy. Like if you came as an alien and you imaged people's brains and you looked at their facial expression as they're running a marathon, you would say somebody is punishing them. Like they're paying for something terrible they've done, and this is how they're, you know, paying their debt to society. And yes, it is kind of miserable, but it's also meaningful and create a sense of achievement and so on. So we're pursuing momentary pleasure rather than truly understanding the depth of what happiness is or what meaning is. And then the second thing is that we're trying to figure out how we externally motivate people. And we have usually a very simple equation that says motivation equals money. And if you're not working hard enough to doing something, I'm not just not paying you enough. I'm not giving you a bonus in the right way. And we just jigger around bonuses and payment. And we say, oh, let's change the payment this way and change payment this way and give a slightly big bonuses here and slightly big bonus there. And we'll create point systems for evaluation and all kinds of things. The beauty of human nature is that lots of things motivate us. And sense of accomplishment and achievement, our title, our connection to work, a connection to the people at work, competing with other people, all of those things motivate us. So we wrote a motivation equation. We would write motivation equals, yes, money is important, but so is achievement, sense of progress, competition, da 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 da. And the question is, how do we use all of them? How do we use all of them to create motivation? And you know, in physics, people look for the perpetual motion machine. How do we get energy from nothing, right, and continue going? In motivation, there is something like that. So imagine two businesses. In one of them, the business doesn't care about motivation. In one of them, they care deeply. In the first business, people are miserable, and the business is miserable, and they're not making lots of money. In the second one, people could be happier, management could be happier, and they could be much more productive and efficient. Everybody wins when we invest in deep motivation. One of the first experiments we did on the question of meaning was not like big meaning, it was little meaning. And here is what we did. We got people to come to the lab and we say, would you like to build a bionicle? And we'll pay you $3 for this bionicle. And people build a bionicle, we took it, we put it under the desk and we say, would you like to build another one? For $2.70. If they say yes, we gave them the next one, and then the next one for 30 cents less and less and less, diminishing wage until they said, stop, no more. Right? And we told all of those people that when they finish the task, we'll take all the bionicle, we'll break them into pieces and prepare them for the next participant. That was what we call the meaningful condition. It's not really meaningful, but it is meaningful compared to the next condition. In the next condition, which we internally call the Sisyphic condition, it started the same way. We said to people, would you like to build a bionicle for $3? And they started doing it. When they finished, we took it from them. We kept it on the desk. And then we said, would you like to build another one for $2.70? If they say yes, they started building the second bionicle. But as they were building the second bionicle, we took the pieces apart from the first bionicle. So we destroyed it in front of their eyes. And then we put it back in the box. And then we said, would you like to build a third one for 30 cents less? And if they said yes, we gave them back the first one that they assembled, we broke. And this way we continued back and forth. And we call this the Sisyphic condition because if you remember Sisyphus from the mythology, he was sentenced to push a rock up the hill, and when he almost got to the top, the rock would roll back and he had to do the same hill. And the idea was that if there were different hills, right, if he were just going over different hills, maybe he would felt some progress. But having to do the same hill over and over was like the depth of demoralizing people. And what happened? Kind of a couple of interesting things. The first one is that people stopped much faster in the Sisyphic condition. The second one is we asked people how much they enjoyed Legos in general. And we wanted to see whether there's a correlation between how much they enjoyed Legos and how much they persisted in this task. And what we saw was that in the meaningful condition, there was a correlation. People who loved Legos did more Bionicles. People who didn't like Legos internally didn't like so much. In the Sisyphic condition, the correlation was zero, which means that we kind of sucked away the joy of assembling Legos. Because you see, the people who loved Legos did not do any more than the people who didn't. Somehow the joy of it just went away. The other interesting insight from this study is we did another version of this experiment in which people did not engage in building Bionicles, but we did this in a business school, and we asked the students to predict how other people would behave in those two environments. Right? So you say, okay, you have an environment with more meaning, environment with less meaning. How many Bionicles will people build differently in those two environments? And we paid people for the accuracy of their predictions. What happened? People predicted that the difference will be in a meaningful condition, people would build more, but they predicted it would be only one Bionicle more. So we understand that meaning matters, but we think it matters very little. In fact, it mattered a lot. People build almost four more Bionicles. So there was a big gap, and people don't understand how meaning is important. And if you think about it as a manager, actually as anybody, if you're trying to motivate people, you could be a school teacher, you could be a parent, whatever it is, if you're trying to motivate people, you have to understand how big is meaning. And if you think that meaning has a very small effect, you would not invest much in it. Only if you understand how big and important it is, you will invest in it.